first item on the agenda is the first item in Dropbox, which is proposed to move the two-way stop at 19th and Lake and replace it with a four-way stop. That map appears in item number. Just folks, anything?
No, sir. Keep it in mind, you know, we always need to test Jake, that's the big one. Keep it in mind, you know, this comes up at a later date, but this is to have a conversation with that second round.
Yeah, we would do this at our normal two times a year. This is actually came as a request from the Joe Weaver, the director of street belt. They've had some significant accidents at that intersection. People thinking there's a four-way stop and there's not, they're pulling out and they're getting hit. Trying to get that addressed right there. It is one of the four corners of the hospital anyway. Probably should have a four-way anyhow. So when we get to the point of doing that, I just wanted to go ahead and get it in line when it was being discussed so that I didn't forget, quite frankly.
Okay. So it'll be on our next biannual meeting on traffic.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
All right. Okay, so. Yes, sir.
So, I don't know if that's strictly for the traffic times and lights and stuff. Do we want to do the same thing for until measures when we were talking about putting out speed bumps or? Because I got a bunch of places on my board that I would like to talk about putting out Rumble strips.
Okay.
And do we want to do it?
Anybody does it have the same measure requirements for Rumble strips or we?
No, sir. You know, we have several other requirements for that, but we are ready for it. But we have one set aside, so I think if council would just recommend this way, we're glad to have them back and we go from there.
Right.
I have a couple there too, so.
Yeah, so I know with some you've already evaluated.
Right.
So if it's just the ones that have been evaluated, send it to us and then we sound like we'll move forward. Because Rumble strips was not a part of this, that's something new.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
So no notice whatsoever.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Cool.
Perfect.
Did we budget two for each ward
that goes along with things? Well, we have a budget. $40,000 ones, and that's what we set aside for common devices.
Okay.
So that's what we set aside.
Oh. Anything else on 9-1? Okay. I have four ordinances, two of which are on the voting agenda. First readings tonight. First one is folks on alcohol beverages.
Yeah, this is one of those things that I'm going to have a lot of Jason with. We've talked about this before, and then we counseled them, and we had Bruce take a look at it, but we tried to address those people that have been trying to circumvent the system with the ABC board with these shindigs and other areas like that. Just stuff they call them the special event center. So we did talk about this about 6 months ago. We talked about it. This is somewhere, I think, and Bruce has vetted it. And I think we got something that's ready for the council to actually send forward. So Jason, I'll let you get it for you.
So what we did was we went through and took the ordinance for our place, compared it to other ordinances around the area, added in several definitions to make it more explicit. That way there's no confusion or open for interpretation on certain things. The club license would be explicable only to nationally recognized clubs, and they have to prove, show that paperwork. So not just anybody can say, open a club and get a club license, which is one way that they're circumventing the alcohol state rule. And the other one would be the special events license. We had it in there already, and it was vague about the 7 and 10 days special events, but limiting those special events license to only those time periods. And that way you couldn't work off of a special events license on a year-round basis.
National club organization. So we're saying, well, I guess I'm thinking more so.
So that the national club registry thing comes from the state. That's actually what they use to get a club alcohol license for the end of that category. They require those to hold those licenses to be national recognized. So actually all we're doing is mimicking the state on that. Our club alcohol license didn't have any stipulations to it at all in the previous ordinance. So
like you didn't have to be a 501c or anything like that.
Anybody could get a club with license for in the city.
keep my doing a special events license, so it'll be 7 days. But this is running the like it's already on a license, and those are the things that we have those problems.
Yes, sir.
It is on its first reading. I mean, we don't have time to go ahead and talk to folks about this before we ultimately, we don't have to, I mean, obviously it's on its first reading tonight. Give us time to go out and talk to folks on the, just take it out. I mean, is there an appetite for tonight is all I'm asking.
I'm okay with it because I have nobody to talk to about it, but if anybody else wants to work, it's fine.
Yeah, I'm okay with it. So if you guys,
yeah,
you need to wait.
I want to wait because I want to talk to Jason about it.
Yeah.
I hear DVD's concern too.
Well, so, I mean, because so we have a couple of months that closed in town.
Yeah.
You know,
the main night, right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I know that I can ask them.
So, not gonna
real quick about that, so when we talk about club license, those motorcycle clubs, they don't have a license. They don't have a business license and or alcohol license. Those are, you know, so they're not getting their alcohol through the state, and that's what these are going to apply to. Your Elks Lodge, your Moose Lodges, FOB.
Or some on Noble Street.
Yes, yes. What we had a problem with was people using the club title to open a bar and then make it kind of, you know, as a private bar, you know, members only type thing. But to fit with the alcohol board under that license, you have to be a nationally recognized club, have a list of membership turned in, all that kind of thing, to fit under that category.
Yeah, I'm putting in this up. So what I just heard you say is, without the little difference, it's, you didn't say it, but that's basically what you said.
I'm sorry.
Not necessarily.
No.
So if they wanted to do like an event, they would have to get a special events license.
Yes, ma'am.
And they could not operate under the club because they're basically making fake clubs in order to.
So for the special
events,
you're looking at two different categories.
Yeah.
The club, that's how one way they were circumventing some of the loopholes,
mm-hmm.
and then the special events. So special events centers and things like that are meant to be rented venues, and those licenses would only apply for events of 7 days or less, or 10 days or less. There's only two license types there. We have people in the city using a special events license operating 365 days a year with an alcohol license, and that's not the intent for the state or the city should have been. So we're just clarifying and tying this up to where those individuals or those organizations can no longer do that. They're going to be held to what a special event truly is.
This is pretty short. Can we maybe do some research on something? What I want to do is I want to make sure. So we have a lot of other activity going on in Anniston, and people can't keep saying we want to train Anniston up or train Anniston up, but we still doing things that's going to cause a whole bunch of heartburn. What's crime and back and stuff. But normally I would say, let's just push this out. I want to do an investigation or something.
That's first reading. So it's normal procedure.
Yeah.
So one thing about August 3rd, is everybody good with the motion we got the title on? Like it's a pretty good
Yes.
Same with the next one. Any additional discussion on alcohol beverages? All right, next one then, which also appears on. Is an ordinance governing mobile food units.
Yes, so that's what again, this is housekeeping. Housekeeping, we need to take care of that, and Jason can just explain that as well. You said occupants approved there, but we have these vendors and then a license and another thing that we're concerned about. So we're just going to clean that up a little bit.
Did I miss the health department closure of this one? Or would we require them to?
Thanks, Governor. That's a separate.
That's a separate ordinance.
I mean, that's what I have as far as before they can get the license and stuff through the city.
Yes, sir, this, that, Jason, you know, this is Jason in town that came up with this, and this is just a way that we can, it helps us a lot, because it's making it possible we can have a way of actually having this recorded. This is one of those things, this is for discussion tonight, and it's not only the voting agenda, but I think this is something that I applaud him for coming up with this, and this will help a lot. So, go through this, he has some talking points, and he can answer, explain this a little more, but I thank Jason and town for coming up with it like that.
So, I gave you a short little checklist there, just, you know, what basic crop share registration ordinance is going to do, what having it in place does for the city versus not having it in place. And this is mainly for your areas, Main Street, things like that, where we have a lot of vacant properties. But those property owners are just sitting on those properties. They're not advertising that they're vacant, not advertising for sale or lease or anything of that nature. So what this allows, and I'll let Tana expound on this a little bit more, because she's actually one that has been pushing this and found this, is it gives the city options. And it, you know, will help streamline a little bit of revenue, not a lot, but it's money that we wouldn't see at all if we don't have something like this in place. And a lot of cities, especially cities with the dynamic of Anniston, are going to this type of process to help with their vacant properties throughout the city. And I'll let Ms. Brian expand on that a little bit more, because she knows all the ins and outs.
Thank you. Before we get going on that, real quick, I'd like to introduce Tristan Taylor to the council and
Sorry,
mayor.
Tristan.
He's the enforcement officer. So y'all, after the meeting or whatever, come up and say hi to him. He's doing a fantastic job. He replaced me. So anyway, with having a vacant property registration, it's for vacant properties and also foreclosed properties. Like Jason mentioned, downtown we have a lot of vacant buildings that we do not know who the owners are. I don't have time, Tristan doesn't have time to sit there and do all the skip tracing and, you know, trying to locate these owners. By having this ordinance in place, the company, third party that is responsible for it, they do all the legwork. We don't pay them anything, but off of the registration fee, for an example, if it's $200 a year, we get $100, we haven't done any work, they get $100, they're doing all the legwork. The registration fees can be tailored to go up each year to help incentivize some of these owners to go ahead and let's list this property so I don't have to pay this vacant registration fee. It gives us contact information so that we can talk to them about the conditions of their building. They don't want to, you know, have to deal with constantly having somebody there, hey, you know, your property's falling in, you've got to take care of this. So it's a benefit for the city. Again, because we don't have staffing, by having a third party do it, it works out well. It's a win-win for both. It's basically, it helps to utilize their resources and not for the city having to spend money for nuisance abatement, for tear down, for board up, this kind of thing. It allows the money to stay in our fund to be better utilized in other areas. So this is all for commercial and for residential. So again, like I said, it's a win-win. Third party does all of the work. We have this registry. We can go ahead then and contact these owners and deal with the situations immediately without us taking the time having to research and find. They do all that legwork for us. But it's very, very progressive. A lot of cities are doing it now. And it, like I said, it's a plus for us because we have so many. So I need to contact them and I need to start enforcement action a whole lot quicker than if I was trying to do all the front end legwork.
So
initially, it still would be a ton of work to get the database put together.
Well, but that's not us doing it. That's a third party that's doing it.
Because I understand, so, and this is just along those lines.
They get their payment through the collection.
Through the collection of the
year. Do we get a percentage of that money too?
It's 50-50.
Okay.
So.
So,
what about maintenance?
So for us to free up.
They take care of all of that.
So for us to free up the time that it takes for her to go through the process of tracking out the yards, just today alone, in the short conversation we had in the office, she was working on something similar to this, and it's one owner to the next owner to the next one, trying to track down who owns these properties, so that for things like light and structures that are in decay, stuff like that, to try to get them to try to fix it before the city comes in and does it for them, it's a lot of legwork. If this would streamline that entire process to take care of the light and the, you know, lapidated structures, even for us if we do decide to tear it down, it would streamline that process, make it a lot smoother and faster. And if the properties aren't in a state where they need to be torn down, say some a property on Noble Street, somebody wants to, they like the building, they want to buy a piece of whatever the case may be. Same thing. We've got to streamline to the property owners. That way we can get those people in contact with the people that want to invest a lot smoother process.
And keep in mind, this is one of the tools that we put in the toolbox so that the nuisance can do the, what we need to do when we talk about cleaning this light. The town can do a lot more. We're working on the nuisance. We have this in place as well. Because she spends a lot of time having to do a lot of this work on the front end and can't do enough enforcement that she needs to do. And that's what we call enforcement and not looking up, you know, the historian. So that's what that's good for that block, right?
Okay, so we're going to back off our. Our city staff about, because once we get streamlined from that, it's going to be a lot of work.
Well, it's not going to matter. You're going through the same thing with the cemetery and other things, it's not that
bad. A bunch of time.
Yeah, so we don't.
This group is doing it, it's doing it in other communities.
Yes, all over the
United States. And y'all checks, y'all done some background checks on them and ensure that we're getting a good success rate, that they're not coming back and saying, well, we can only find 40% of the owners.
Nothing is a 100% guarantee, but you know, their success rate is very good throughout the country. They do a lot in the Midwest as well. They've also been partnering and talking to and giving me information as far as land banking. So that's another tool in our toolbox that we have talked about many times, and they've put me in contact with a gentleman in Georgia, down here in the South, who does a lot of land banking, putting those together. We have sample ordinances. So, you know, we're looking at broadening our horizons to be able to tackle the blight and get people to be responsible. You know, if they want to get these properties taken care of, great. If they don't, we'll still move forwards with code enforcement action against them. So.
Well, I think it's about many. Most of the groups that are not here is light and terrible looking buildings downtown. I think it's the first step we need to revitalize this town. And I would like to talk about that tonight. I don't know if anybody else is here.
No, we don't have the ordinance.
You're right, we're just going to have a conversation.
Yeah, so I needed
to.
To that point, if they're not willing to pay, can you charge them for the taxes? What do you think? Yeah, I'm not trying to charge them for the gas.
Right.
I'm trying to add, I'm going to add a little bit. We have so many people that's not doing anything with the property, is it? And if we do an abatement,
if we do an abatement on it, we do charge it to the ad valorem taxes,
okay.
Yes, sir.
Election falls on this other group, this third group.
Right, yeah.
It is another revenue stream for us at that point. If they're registering a vacant property, if it's costing them $100 to register and we're splitting it 50-50, well, we get $50 for every vacant property that gets registered. I want to make sure that if we can push this on through and get it done, that we make sure that we dedicate those funds
to
blight and code enforcement and blight removal, so that they don't get lost in the general fund somewhere else.
Yeah,
I want to make sure that the ordinance gets written such that these monies that are being collected on behalf of code enforcement go into the code enforcement's budget for remediation efforts.
Tell me realistically, how long do you think it would take to get something to the council?
We can get something sent over to Bruce and have him go through it and then ready for the next council meeting.
Let's say.
We can say it.
Let's say the second one in August.
Okay, that's fine.
Do they have a formal agreement?
Yeah, they have a formal agreement, all of that.
So since that, we put that on the work session at the meeting?
Yes, sir.
It was a set of things.
Yeah. Okay. All right, next one then, fire prevention.
That's the cleanup, sir. That's something that's an amendment that Bruce has done for us because we had something with court enforcement was enforcing when it should have been public works. So we just amended and moved it back where it should be.
Okay.
And when it comes to
the stormwater.
Stormwater.
So would this be the third? It's not the August 3rd.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right, Mr. Fox, sidewalks.
The council member Harris's ward, so we've had discussions, so I really defer to council member Harris. But keep in mind, I want to keep in mind that what was for the sidewalks last year, there was $75,000 put in the council member ward one for council member Jenkins, which he deferred to council member Harris, which came up to about $250,000. And you'll see what we got there. It's going to be about $800,000 to make it sure. But we don't want to continue to pay this consultants when we're not going to get there.
It's very disappointing because we were hoping to have a walkable community in Golden Springs where the residents could walk to the grocery store, walk to the drugstore. And they can't do that now. It's a dangerous thing. You see people out on the road there. I mean, a man in a wheelchair. And I've had several people ask about it, and several years ago this was started, and Mark is done started, the inquiry into it is done, and it's very, very disappointing, but when I see the number of how expensive it's going to be, I think it would be very irresponsible to spend taxpayer money on an $800,000 sidewalk so some people could walk to the store, to the grocery store, and to the pharmacy grocery store. And on the other day, Dave Barnett and I met with some residents there, and we told them the truth. This has gone way over what we thought it was going to be. And they said, well, they didn't even want it anyway. I was surprised. I thought everybody wanted it, and I found out not everybody out there wants it. And so they said, well, can we use the funds for our streets that are in terrible shape? And I told them I would check because we do have a need for some paving. So anyway, and I think that was smart on your part, Mr. Folks, to stop that contract. We already spent $33,835 and not to waste any more money because they've already saved it's going to be $800,000. And so I think that was smart on your part to cease that study. And so anyway, I'm going to be looking at some other areas that hopefully we can spend this money. We have infinite needs, and we have finite resources. You all know that. So anyway, disappointing, but oh well, that's the way it is.
I think that from a legal standpoint, the money's not spent for what it was budgeted.
Keep in mind, they are going to be reallocated, but keep in mind it's the bond money, and as long as we use that money for capital improvement projects, we're good. This is bond money. So we're good, as long as it's capital improvement projects, we'll be good.
I don't have any concerns with it other than I'd like to see us also reconsider extending the sidewalk down 10th Street. Maybe that's not important today with the news. School board is looking at closing that school. I mean, that was the purpose of that, was to get a creative walkable path there.
Well, here's where we are here. Again, local flooding issues in West Anniston as well as Gold Springs. We have the engineering work being studied being done right now. Can't give you a number on what that. The last time we talked about that, Jay was part of that, and that Gold Springs was about $2 million for the finish the whole thing. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about possibly changing
half of two streams in the Gold Springs. Floodplains that we're addressing that ultimately come together at the point, but the two that run through there in the previous study out at 21st and Parkland was around 600. So, you know, I mean, how those numbers change since those studies were done is what we're learning. But I would suggest this, that we get finance to give us a list of these allocations that haven't been spent. Let's get that in as we work through this budget process. Right. Let's have those numbers in front of us so we can look at it in a holistic way and try to decide what's the best use of these monies. Because it may open up, you know, we may open up some avenues for the Rescue Act funds that we didn't see as a pathway before because the money only goes so far.
Right.
But if there's monies like this out there that, you know, we budgeted that didn't get spent, let's talk about where they are. It's, you know, this group may decide that, hey, we want to dump it all in the reserves. I don't know. But, I mean, I'm not suggesting that it get used one way or another.
We're a deal for it.
Yeah. I mean, there are a lot of pieces and parts, and just having that knowledge would make us more effective.
That's what I'm working on for you all to say exactly. Look, there's money that we can't use, like $230,000 that we've made to put pads down in a couple places. Can't use that $60,000. So that's quite a bit of funds, but keep in mind this is bottom line. It has to be used for capital improvement. So we do need to move those forward. But I plan to have something more legible than what I have here. So we talked about that today. I got it together. One thing that I wish council would help us on and help me on this, when we did the had a consultant do a paving study. If we can start getting a concise way we want to do paving. We have gas tax, we have other things within public works, but we don't have a plan on how we want to pave these roads. We gave that to you all. If we could come up with something, paving these roads, I think, if citizens want to see what we're doing, I think if we start paving the road within the community, that really needs to be done. The council would just give us an idea of what they'd like to do, so we can see what we use that money for paving. We need to do some paving in our streets in our community. So if you could use the study, I don't know if Councilman Murray, you can talk about that, Bill, give him a copy of that study. But if you can just do it,
we need to just reproduce the copy for us all.
Okay, yes.
And it may be worthwhile having a work session dedicated to that. And sit down with a big map on the table and let's talk about where our problems are and our areas of greatest need. I know they graded those things as worst to best roads. I don't believe it should be a ward by ward thing. There are bad roads in every ward, but those dollars are only going to go so far. If we can make a greater impact in one area over another, if the roads are equally bad, then you know we just need to kind of come up, formulate a real plan. And there may be some instances where we can go to our partners in the county commission and say, hey, we've got X number of dollars that we can dedicate towards this paving. Can you partner with us and help us get a little further down the road?
What I would like to do during this budget process is really set that aside, and so we have a direction. So Public Works Director knows exactly what has to happen so we can hold them accountable instead of having a amount of money, but let's have what we're going to pave from you all so we can actually have that upon our capital improvement as we move forward. So I look at this number here, and I have before the end of the week, I have a number for the council so you look at it and we talk about this more. But we do need to talk about paving here. We're going to talk
about think about things like these rumble strips. I know we've got these mobile speed pumps that we've got money allocated for but rumble strips are something that you would put in when you put the asphalt down to kind of affect traffic. So it may make some sense to have all this again. cross off, so that we didn't have to cut all the lines.
It's still important.
Yeah, and so, but I think that we ought to be looking at it in those kind of capacities and maybe dedicate a whole work session to it and get it over.
That's right. Let's see.
All right, before we get to flow subjects, which are really on the budget, and this will kick off the budget tonight, with the council's permission and indulgence, we have two things we need to add to the agenda tonight to the consent agenda, if that's okay with y'all. And it's two items related to freedom riders. It's, we've talked about it before, the study of visitorship and economic impact of JSU, that's $25,000 contract. And then with J.A. Wilburn and infrastructure needs assessment, that's $58,000 contract. We need to move those to the consent agenda tonight. That's good with y'all, so we can get this.
And all this grant, but that's grant.
Yeah.
Yes.
Y'all agree with that?
Yes.
Okay.
I just want to add something. We'll come back to the council agenda, but Jackson put out the survey last week for the four sites that we're looking at with City Hall, and maybe you can push that maybe another week or something like that. But the idea from that survey to me, you guys might have different opinions, was to help us kind of dial it down to at least two locations so that maybe we can work with some people and create some presentation of how this possibly can look, or you know, what the next phases are. So my question is, how far do we want to allow this survey to go until we get to that point in getting these presentations done, being that I don't know how much longer we have and then start building.
Hey, y'all are more than two. I'm good with the existing federal courthouse and the
next. It's no way on the survey. It's no way.
It's not close.
They're both clearly the favorites of the community based on this survey. Now, I would question the validity of the survey, quite frankly.
It's not
we have something that said, hey, which of these four sites do you like? Without any information attached to it, I feel like there needs to be some kind of, hey, if we did it on the south end of this property right here, this is what we're talking about doing. These are the pros in it, these are the cons in it, and this is the kind of, I mean, it goes back to that statement I made a couple months ago about, hey, if we're going to do this, let's invest in it. This is a big deal for the city. Let's invest in it. Let's hire four firms and pay them all a fixed commission that is credited back to the final design if we pick their design and move forward, and let them put together a presentation package that says, hey, if we're going to do, you know, we got Architect A that's doing something on this site right here, and he develops a schematic plan for us or a rendering or whatever his firm feels like they need to do to sell their piece of the project. Somebody else is doing a federal courthouse. Somebody else is doing a Winn-Dixie. Somebody else is doing the Anniston Auto Parts thing. And let's present them all to us in a holistic way. Now we can look at them and we can really weigh the pros and cons of if it goes on this site, it triggers this, this, and this. Just us saying, I like that one best. I mean, they all have merit. They all have significant merit. So us arbitrarily picking it just based off of, hey, do you like this or this, is, in my opinion, short-sighted on our part. That we should be looking at it in a bigger way. I mean, like I said, putting some kind of competition together that involves a commission to these firms so that you get their best effort. Right. You can't ask somebody to do something like that for free, but and I don't care who the four firms are. I'm not suggesting that either. I'm just suggesting that we put something out there, let four different groups compete on these four different sites, present something to us, and then we go back with a follow-up survey here that says, okay, your initial request was the Winn-Dixie building and the federal building. Here are the four sites and how they would be developed in the schematic format. Do you still feel the same way? Is the federal building still the best building? Is Winn-Dixie still the best building? Or all of a sudden, you know what? The synergy that's created by the Anniston Auto Parts site and the connection to the trail and the connection to the federal building all of a sudden looks appealing to somebody that didn't before, or the connection of the federal, of the building to the city hall, to the meeting center, and the ability to, you know, I mean, you talk about, hey, we can do some shared, some staff, and we can do some things differently, and it makes this more efficient, makes it better. I mean, all of those things have significant merit, but we're not weighing them in their full perspective, or in as full of perspective as I believe we should. We still would be weighing it in its full perspective, but at least we would have some kind of vision that we could put forth to the community that they could say, you know, I like that one. But not just a vision, it would also have a cost ramification to it. So that, hey, if I do it on Anniston Auto Parts site, well, we know we have some environmental issues there we've got to clean up, or we can't dig in the dirt, or we can't do this, and so this site's going to cost a little more than this site. If we go into the Winn-Dixie building, it's a little bigger than we need it to be. It's a great location, creates a gateway entrance into our downtown. It's a great location, but we may need to find a partner to go in that building with us so that that building gets fully used. I mean, all of these things need to be vetted.
Well, it's
all these things that you're saying, the conversation is going on right now. We have someone besides the city meeting center, that's just an architectural. We have someone actually looking at private, you know, private government,
public partnership.
And Winn-Dixie is not, we don't need that much room, but we got somebody actually putting these things together as we speak. And we have not paid them anything, but they're putting the county with the federal government. We got somebody doing this as we speak. Because we're talking about obstacles right now as we speak, we got somebody doing these things to bring forward to you. Just like
Sydney said,
we already have someone look, architect already taking a look at this. We have things in place ready to present to council. Only thing, the Auto Parts building is not going to be that money, it's way down anyway. But we have these things, because Herbert, council said when he first said it, we have someone actually doing this thing now. But we need to move fast, because we don't want these people to continue to be drug.
They're all different firms.
All different firms that are looking at these right now. Already the same person we had with the public and the private and the government, they're looking at this with the Winn-Dixie. There's some good ideas with that, just like the same thing with federal buildings. We have some problems with federal. We've been looking at this. We have not just put this out to survey. We've thought about this holistically. Staff have been involved in it. We got a process ready to go right now because we want to move as quick as possible. We have some place in place right now to move this forward. And we already also have an alternative plan for the Auto Parts place, but I wanted to give council four things so we can start moving this forward. So we got this thing in place. All we got to do now is the council giving me permission, we pull the trigger.
Yeah, it's like a good presentation.
What is the purpose of this survey?
Just involve the community so we can feel involved. At least,
so how about this?
We're
just having something right now, because if we're just trying to get there, just sit there reading the paper, we are.
What I'm saying, Council, we really got a good, clear, the vision of the council is pretty much the vision of the community, right? From what we saw right now. But now we can come back and say, this is the logic of what we want to do, just like the council Jenkins said. Yes, though, thank you for your help. These are the logic, and these are where we're going forward. Then we start telling the public, This is the reason why this makes more sense. Because right now you've got people just checking, you know, this is their feeling. But when we start talking about logistics, then we can give them something to look at. We got that already ready. We got that close to ready to go. So whenever the council is ready for me to start doing this thing, we can start having this conversation.
How would the four firms chosen?
Because we'd already start talking with.
How would
it? We knew someone who actually knew the federal court as well. Architect with the federal court as well. We had an architect, a local architect that had already worked with the city meeting center, and we had an architect that already worked with and this other one that's coming in. This is a consultant group that's coming in and wants to pitch what they can do with the public and private partnership.
Yeah, we're not paying.
We're not paying.
No. I mean, they're doing this.
We're not paying. One more person picking is one architect on the city meeting center. We're not paying anyone anything.
So we'll get the presentations.
I will start having that conversation.
And I think we do that. You know, some of these officers said that.
not paying them anything except the one hour pay, and that's because that was way big, started way back when we just looked for one place. But we have not paid either one of these people anything, so they're coming trying to sell themselves.
Okay, then the last item would be the city meeting updates, which begin, you know, tonight officially kicks off our budget cycle.
Yes, sir.
All driven by statute, and so we'll have our first public hearing next,
or the next meeting.
That next week, public hearing, but this is proposed, the city manager's proposed, and I think it was done for everyone. The minor change that we made, Julie sent out to everyone to let them know, of course, the police department agreed as a team player to give up one vehicle because the party was in dire need of two other vehicles and other things that the council brought forward at the 99th at a meeting. We made those changes and sent them out to council, so those, so it's up to the council time to next the rules and then we can start the public hearing.
This is the same one that you had in your email, other than I just added in some of the letters that they threw, and it was on the original one. But same information, no numbers have changed from the email that I sent her.
It's already been sent to share with the public, so it's all on my site, so she's already sent her public to see. So the next meeting will be a cut call for public consultation. The Julie will go through it again, or a